be back on Thursday.
Charge on. Second informal conversation that we're having from the self-published VIP project space here at the Photographer's Gallery. So for a week we've been invited to move our office and our library in the third floor of the Photographer's Gallery. It's called Business as Usual, and more or less that's quite true. Part of the business is as usual. Some of it is not as usual, and this is slightly unusual. Which is, we run a series of informal conversation with sub-publishers, artists that we had the opportunity to work with or whose work we like. And the conversation around some of the theme presented in the publication that we just released, which is called Sub-Publish Be Happy, a DIY Photobook Manual and Manifesto, which is co-published by Aperture with SPBH Edition, which is our own imprint. Yesterday we talked with Anouk Kruithof and Peter Puklus. In the beginning of the conversation was prompted by the idea of play as a methodology, as a subject of the practice in relation to bookmaking. The starting point is the idea of performance and the book as an object. And I'll be talking with two artists, Melinda and Magee, both of which have been producing interesting publications, Melinda for longer time than Liam, who is doing his MA right now, and in a very different manner in terms of content as well, and strategies in their practice. So I think maybe we should start having you two explain your practice in relation to this idea of a performance. So when we're thinking about performance, we're thinking both in terms of the book prompting a performance of the audience, of the reader, let's call it, which apply for both your publication that we'll be discussing today, or some of your publication. And then specifically in yours, maybe later we can talk about also how some of the publication come from an engagement with an audience and a performance. But first of all, maybe I'm going to show some images that you brought today that maybe can help us in describe what I've been saying.
Anyone who's about my practice is kind of very much based within kind of questioning the constraints and the theories behind the photographic practice, but very much about the contemporary photographic practice. So my work's always kind of looking at the kind of suggested notions about what photography is kind of nowadays, how it's changing, what things help change it, so from technological advances, discourse, theory, and practice. So my main kind of focus is always about kind of questioning this idea about what photography is, what the medium is now, but also what it could be in the future. So the kind of fundamental ideas behind my books are equally the same as in my own practice, which is very much about questioning this idea about taking a source, medium, a tool, whatever it may be, and really questioning the very notion of what makes that, you know, its format. So for me, the biggest thing when looking to create a book was that it really matched the projects that I'm making. It wasn't making a project around just having a book so I could say that I've got a, you know, monograph. It was very much about making artwork which happened to be in the form of a book. So it was very much about kind of the craftsmanship, the process, but also this kind of tactility, which is really important to me as an artist, but also to my ideas around photography. So the picture you can see now is it's kind of like a deconstructed of the parts of the book on my second publication before it was actually even put together. So that was in Amsterdam a couple of years ago, and I wanted to take the idea of kind of putting the book and formatting it together as an entirety, but also showing the process of what the fundamental bits are of bookmaking, which is the design, the construction, the layout, the format, which is what you can see in this picture. That kind of leads on to the next question. This is me in a knife. That's because on my second publication, this is split open. They're all Japanese folds. So the images are printed on the inside and on the outside, and the way to reveal the inside images is you have to cut them open with implements. So I used a kitchen knife. Daniel kindly took this picture of me looking a bit menacing. Do you want to move on? Then on to more menacing things.
Can I just stop you?
Yeah.
Because yesterday we briefly discussed that Anouk said something about her practice and her book practice, where she basically said, well, because I was introducing this idea that there's a long tradition in contemporary book writing. So artists using the book as a way to challenge the notion of truth itself, as you mentioned, both in terms of content and the form. That isn't quite so prevalent in the history of photobooks, where for a very long time they walk away to a specific format and look. So I guess to me it's interesting that a lot of your books, not only, and what she was saying is that to her it's obvious that she does challenge the idea of the book form, because she also challenges the idea of photography and practice. So the two things you just have them to, you know, she just to carry on her own interest both in terms of photographic content as well as the form in the exhibitions of this book. And I wonder if it seems to resonate in what you say. Choosing all the material and ended up producing a book which is
So one of the things that's really interesting about this body of work, that there's a lot of pictures of obviously hard pornography, soft pornography. And as a female looking at that kind of work, it's kind of interesting to work out kind of your feminist ideals around it, or your idea, but also very much about this kind of idea about the representation of the female form, which is kind of notable within photography. Also, it's a very dominant male industry, so it's sort of female kind of artists working in it. It's a natural kind of affiliation I found to kind of research on that kind of imagery and kind of really start crushing my ideas around it. So I kept finding all these kind of some really beautiful pictures, some horrific pictures of kind of the female represented in his archive. And then I ended up turning the pictures over and was like, oh, hang on a minute, what's more interesting to me? Because I've seen a lot of these pictures, some kind of the same stylized, you know, composition of the picture I've seen before. I turned them over and I was really intrigued about the backs of the pictures, the traces, the marks, the actual histories. Kind of the indelible quality of people that physically left the written marks. Also, it spoke quite a lot about kind of the archive, which was about the work. So I ended up producing a book which is printed on two sides. So the fronts of the pictures are printed on the inside, so they're unsealed, and the backs are printed on the front of the journal. The backs of books have been printed, and books have been made for a number of years, not anything new. But what I wanted to do was kind of repression this kind of the way that you look into a book, how do you search something, how do you peep into something. So inside the Japanese vaults, I think it's you can peep into them and have a look. But actually what was really interesting there was this kind of obsession with everyone wanting to actually see what was inside. So the performance was around the fact that I use a knife, which is kind of quite aggressive but quite strong, suggestive kind of tool to use anyway, and actually slice open these papers to release the pictures inside. So I gave people the opportunity to have a book which has no images, they didn't think, but they could look through, and actually have some people chose anything to be open. So it was kind of really interesting, so it became that real question also when you're working, so it became like it's a real rapport with your purchaser, which is amazing actually, because a lot of times you just put it on a bookshop and you wander around and you speak to your bookseller and go, oh, how many are sold, and they send you an invoice, and it's kind of quite businessy, but actually with this element, it's really nice kind of interaction with people where I said, you know, what do you want to happen? And they were like, right, I want this page cut, that page cut, and it kind of became quite playful and quite fun. And actually, there was a control element for me, but also there was very much a control for them, and I could just take this regulator.
How was it like when they were opening it and seeing this really quite distressing images? Because of the kind of nature of the, you know, the kind of playfulness of it that was brushed away, or actually there was an engagement in the content of it.
Yeah, I think there's definitely people had already peeped through the pictures as well. It's printed on such light paper that if you really kind of put it to the light, it kind of comes transparent anyway. There are a few people who are like, well, they can get through like that. But also there's a lot of really nice pictures in there, they're not all.
There's something that is, I guess, is can be related to young publication, which is called Top Dog. And there's a switch to show images from that, which is this element of engaging the audience in the way that they interact with the content of the book. This element of, in the way that you constructed the object, that you force a specific kind of engagement and a set of choices that the viewer had to make when they handle the book, or I should say the envelope of the book. But maybe let's start and describe what it is.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so the book Top, is around the idea of multiplicity within a single object, but also indecision. So when the viewer buys the book, the first thing they have to do is make a decision which perforation they use. That first thing means it kind of makes them engage with the value of the book. So throughout all my work, I'm interested in transactional value, and I was really interested in making a book which had an element of activation to it. So through the dis- destruction or partial destruction of the book, it negotiated that transformation between.
So just to be clear, so the book is inside it and held up by this, which both sides are perforated.
Yep.
So you have to make a decision which one is the top, which you open it.
Yeah.
What is the direction that you...
And that kind of insets a doubt in the viewers to ask how they read the book. So once they've had to make that decision-making process, then they can come through with the book, which is ambiguous both into its orientation and in the beginning and end of the book. So it's got a double spine. So it means the reading of the book is completely perpetual, there's no beginning or end, but equally all the images within the book are completely ambiguous to their orientation. So what I wanted to do in terms of the viewer was make them essentially mimic what was happening with the objects, with the book itself. So there was this kind of realisation through trying to understand the book, and hopefully my intention was for them to physically engage with it, and using multiple object orientations as an object, it would then be mimicked, the hands in the book would be mimicked by the viewers themselves. So in that sense, it's kind of relating it back to the performativity. It's about them kind of performing with the book completely on their own. So it's, it's something I hope happens, but I don't necessarily get to witness.
Yeah. Then how did the form of the book come about? How did you think about creating an object of this nature? Because there's something that I heard you talking about it before.
Yeah.
It's interesting that there wasn't a body of photograph that you made other than your actual house in the book. It was actually the way around. You had an idea for a publication, and then you started creating the material.
So the book came about through the Campbell Book Prize, which commissioned an alumni from Campbell College of Art to make an artist's book with the press there. And it was, for me, really important to be invited to propose a book, because I've never worked in book form before. So I'd always worked with photographs and understanding the role of the photograph in its relation to representing objects, and also using it as a document for my exploration of transactional value. But I'd never thought of the book being an outlet for that. So when I had the chance to propose an idea for a book which would explore my general thinking and practice as an artist, this is kind of what I arrived at, because I think it kind of explains my general thinking. So whether that be the transactional value or whether that be multiplicity, it's meant to be summarised within the book. So all the images made for the book only came about once I kind of made the object. So the book as an object arrived before the images were made for the book. So in that sense, it was really interesting working in the studio when I was making the images, always having the, always envisaging them physically as an object and how they would kind of come about in that.
So do you feel that it's very similar in the way that you operate generally in your practice? So that you think about an idea, that idea becomes an object.
No, not necessarily, but I think making a book in this way has helped me kind of expand my practice, definitely. So previously, my work's always had a performative element, and it's always resulted in a series or a single image. So whether that be...
Do you want to explain one?
The most obvious example would be when I exploited the sale and returnability. So I'd purchase self-assembly furniture, make various sculptures out of the furniture, then repackage it and return it for the value that I purchased it for on the same day of purchase. The only thing left would be the images of the sculptures made, or the box of furniture waiting to be. So then I was kind of thinking about the object as photographed. So that was a project where I was using the temporal or ephemeral nature of the photograph on the photograph as a document to kind of highlight performance thing for it, whereas this is much more about performativity with objects which are in the book, but also creating a book which encourages performativity. Mm-hmm.
Because I was just thinking that, of course this is a generalization, but traditionally a photographer will create a set of images and then will think about that set of images in the context of a publication or an exhibition. Well, I think there is a different way here that seems to be coming across, which is that maybe you think about the book form and then the images being the archive or other kind of images then reflect. Would you think that that's not the case with your work?
I think depending on what kind of artist you are, what kind of delivery you do, and what you make, it really depends on kind of your concept. And I'm very concept driven. I think to around kind of the idea of the theory, and not necessarily some of the academia behind it, but all of us around the kind of questions. And actually, for me, I'm having made like 3 books now, and I never thought I'd ever make books, so I have to stop doing that. There's something around the success of a book and the fact that the success of any project is very much on the delivery of having a very key, clear concept, which is delivered in the most informed, appropriate format and manner it should be. Whether that be a book, whether that be an exhibition. I don't make my work going, okay, I'm going to have an exhibition. I make my work because there's a drive, a passion, a need, fundamental need for me to make this work about something that I'm really excited by, inspired by, frustrated by, whatever my kind of ideas and things are often very excited and quite motivated in my work because the foundations are driven out of. But actually it's very much about what's the most appropriate format. And it has happened for a few of the works I've done recently that the format happens to be a book. I'm sure you also in your research where you're thinking about your ideas and how formative work. That kind of that audience participation, that way that you kind of move and
really interesting.
It seems to equally be
a
thinking about the
way. Yeah, but I do think that is quite really important in photography. Because I think, you know, the traditional way to think about it is that, you know, you come with a portfolio of images and then you find the kind of house of it in a form of a book.
Yeah.
Well, I think, of course this is a generalization, but I'm sure there's a list of exceptions. But I think a kind of younger generation thinks differently. So if you think about the idea, you pursue it, and then does that lead into an exhibition or a book or online? It seems more fluid, where either the exhibition or the book isn't the final best form for a project. But the other thing that I was going to, that we just mentioned at the beginning was that not only the books require a engagement in its form, so being open to another, deciding how to look the images and read the images, or cutting pages. In your case, you also there's an element of performance around the making of the book. So I mean, we worked on a book together that is SBBH Book Club Volume 6. In which you smoke the book. So I'll let you explain the project and the kind of images for it.
Yeah, so the project, I mean, so Bruno's, you know, the book club, you come together, Bruno very kindly asked you to deliver a project which you've not been seen before, something new. So I take years to make work. So
because they're all the same format.
Yeah.
The books.
Yeah.
So different artists are invited to engage with a specific format of the book, which is mostly the size and the cover.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So when you're presented with something like that, you know, you have to think about what can you deliver, what can you make, which can fit with their ethos, but also kind of my practice. So I found a collection of old Polaroids I had on notice that had been unexposed. I had a fire and a flood at my studio. So, as you do when you have something's burning down and there's like 8 fire engines and you're kind of cordoned off and you're told to wait before a ceiling comes in, I'm a bit like, what do I do? So I start photographing. So I use my iPhone and I take some pictures and I'm just waiting, just kind of like, you know what to do. So, the project is a result of the kind of the detritus, the left remnants of the fire and the flood that I had. So I made this is kind of a good indication about that we had the format, we had a discussion, and then I actually made the product not as good around that idea of that format. So the book is kind of a collection of black and white pictures of kind of really dusty, smoky work, really abstracted. And then there was this one element for me which I couldn't get rid of with this whole project, was the fact that when I stood there with the fire, which I hadn't experienced the fire before, in a situation of a house or a studio, the smell of smoke you just cannot get rid of. And I washed my hands repeatedly, I washed my hair, but like so much that I couldn't get rid of the smell of the smoke. And I thought, actually, what something so basic and fundamental and kind of very cathartic for me also for this project was what happens if you add the most basic other central element to a project, you add the element of smell. So I thought, what the one thing that you can't get from stripping those pictures is that smell, that stench that came from the work. So like, what happens if you can create an environment, which is basically what I'm doing, for the audience to sit with what I smelled at that time, so they can have brought back to what the situation is. So I ended up hand smoking all the books that me and Bruno made, little smoke houses which are here, and they smoke for like 10-15 minutes each. And so then when they're kind of sealed, they're literally hot off the press because they're hot still. And then you focus them straight away. But it was just this kind of amazing thing that once you kind of open this bag, you get this really strong smell, kind of this slightly peaty, whiskey, quite nice really, smell and eventually it fades, which is kind of the reality of what happens. So I spent 3 years trying to clean and get rid of this smell, and finally I got rid of it, and then I smoked this stuff, and I smell like it again.
I mean, it's interesting that that how people read that smell, and of course, the same thing, how people read your photobook, it's very, I mean, I experienced that many times, because people pick it up and they know the context of it, is actually a very reassuring smell. People find it really comforting, because it's quite, kind of Christmassy, as you said, kind of whiskey or sausages type of smell. And I don't think that I never thought of that as a problem. It's just the way that many people interact and read, in this case, smell, is really up to that. But there's the other element, which is that you do this in front of the audience.
Yeah.
And I wonder why. You could have smoked at home and then deliver the books, but...
Yeah. I think it's also, for me, there's something... It's kind of strange thing because these situations, like performance things, make me so nervous. Like I get so horribly nervous, and it's almost like part of my practice, which I'm kind of when I've been thinking about it recently, is it is very much around kind of pushing myself to the absolute limits, physical limits of what I think I can manage to do. And that's very much part of my practice. It becomes even more and more the more I develop. And these elements, kind of the physically having to set fire to something, control it, manage it in front of an audience, is this kind of amazing kind of pressure that you've got for yourself, and there's something incredibly rewarding when you do it, but also there's an environment which for this was really important to create. I mean, when the fire was happening, there was so many people that were all called off. There's an inclusivity about this, which even though people are standing and watching, they're still part of something. And actually, Sean O'Hagan said in the review he wrote about it, was kind of this reeked of photobook when he left, which I thought was really beautiful. And this idea of kind of this inclusiveness about people being kind of part of it, felt a bit like a fair, like a bit like going to, like a bonfire. Like, there's that kind of atmospheric quality to it, which I think is really important. For me also, there are so many, people make so many books, and there are thousands and thousands of books. And for me, I don't think it's engaging personally to just have a book launch, which is there, you sign a book. I'm not interested in that. It's not me. I don't like it. I don't really want to sit there writing things down. Also, I can't write. I can, but it is bad. So, for me, this kind of element where you're showing about the process is actually really interesting. It makes people, I hope that it makes people kind of rethink about things, remember it a little bit more, but also feel that they've had a really interesting couple of seconds in the present, which I think is so much about living now. My work is about making people experiencing it in the present rather than seeing it online or kind of writing it when I was doing it delivered. It's about being there and witnessing something. Also, it's unique. It never happens again. I can plan it, but it's always going to change. And I love that about it.
So this is what we did have a Tate, where they didn't know how to have a fire.
Damn them, they wouldn't let us wipe the Tate.
So in this case, you used, what is it called, dry?
It's
the
smoke machine.
A smoke machine, yeah. Where there wasn't about smoking the book, it was more creating an atmosphere around the book.
Absolutely, and also kind of visually, kind of creating a situation where it's actually quite beautiful. And the one thing that you could see within that other work, the kind of performance, was when you have a lot of smoke in one place, you know, it really starts to clog your vision, it starts changing it, and it starts to become slightly mystified, distorted, and actually there's a really beautiful visual with that, which is when my studio broke down, it looked like that. I mean, it kind of that cloudy vision, and that's something which it's trying to bring all these elements in. So every kind of performance I do around this book is always different. It's always trying to have that other element which is fundamentally at the fire, which I'm trying to bring to the audience, which is originally the smell, which is the original one, which is all about the actual smoking of the book, but this is about the kind of atmospheric qualities of actually witnessing something, and there's something very beautiful. I mean, I don't know about everyone else, I'm obsessed with fire, but that's me. But don't worry about it. I left my matches at home. But there's something really beautiful watching kind of the wind whispering, the birds are smoking. It's very comforting to me and very beautiful. So that kind of element of the tea, obviously we can't burn it, anything. So we was kind of representing that kind of worked really well.
Do you ever think about how the people that buy your book will? Do you ever play in your mind how they're going to handle it and what they're going to do with it?
I had a chance to watch people engage with it is someone from a complete, like a non-art background completely. And in that sense it was really interesting because they came at it with a much more innocent art and they were much more kind of probably more understanding of the concept than someone who was kind of more like well versed in like the language of photography in the book. Because they had a much more innocent approach to it. What you're talking about that, it's like, I think what we're both trying to do is taking like Brechtian elements, the way he talks about theatre, and when you go to a Brecht play, it's like, this is a play, this is theatre. So in that sense, I think a lot of what's been talked about so far is the kind of the acknowledgement that this is a book. It's not just a book which facilitates viewing images, it's an experience within itself, and it's experience of so watching someone who's not so used to experiencing photo books, it's a more like magnified experience of what I intended, so like a really exaggerated version of what I kind of hoped to achieve. So in that sense, for me, that's what makes a successful artist book or a successful photo book, in like your awareness of what you're viewing. It's not just, you know, it's not just a white cube space in a sense when you're viewing the images, but it forces you to engage with the work in a new way.
Yeah. It's always kind of the question, depending on what kind of you want to do an artist, there's always that kind of idea about trying to get people to engage in something in kind of a different way, which is like not necessarily new, but maybe new to them, and actually make a lot of success and a lot of profit to actually it's kind of versatility to work from a whole range of different spectrums. It's not just about touching kind of academics at this level, critics, you know, that's great, you can do that. Mm. But actually it's very much about the engagement around just normal people who pick up your book and look at it and you can like, see that kind of exaggerated way, but they're kind of moving and changing and they experience it and it's that kind of, that's quite amazing, I think.
Yeah. I mean even when you did this on Tate, it really felt, and that was a kind of general audience, I mean, there were people there, this was doing offerings. But it was on the Turban Hall, which meant that there were a lot of tourists and just visitors coming in who had no specific interest in photography or not specific knowledge in photo books.
Mm.
And I mean, it was a spectacle.
Mm.
And as such, I think I don't know how much they engage in the content of the book, if really then they wanted to engage, why that was happening. But there's something, you know, entertaining, but not in a derogative sense, but in a kind of positive sense, about the whole experience and existence of the book and space.
I think the job of an artist it really is to kind of, it is to kind of engage with the whole world, it's to deliver that. And if you can do that in a more studio way, mics in this context.
So, I'm conscious of time. We want to have it all done in an hour. Especially for the online audience. Your computer, but I had two questions I'm asking everybody when they come here, and then we open to the audience if they have questions about your thoughts or anything else being discussed. The two questions, which also are related to the content of the book, is one, what tips would you give to people that are interested in making a book? You know, it can be from the trivial to philosophical to anything. And yesterday, somebody in the audience asked an interesting general question, which was, what book do you have in your mind now? As in, what kind of book have you come across that really, and why that book, interests you and invokes its form or content? And that has to be the best one or the latest one. It's just the latest one, I guess. So, should we start with the tips?
Yeah.
We have time today.
Yes. Tips. Okay. So, I'd say, I guess, first of all, if you want to self-publish, start saving now. You need some money. The key to successful self-publishing is distribution. You need to make sure you have a list of distributors. That if you have a nice collective of people, make sure you're really good and you share your contacts, because if one person has a good contact for a distributor, and then you have one, if you share them, then you both have two. Before you know it, you can have like 10 and it's super easy. That is really one of the keys to get a book out there. The kind of more one about your practice, about the more emotive one, is just never make any book that you don't want to buy yourself. Be really true to what your concept is, and don't try and do gimmicks, don't try and be fashionable, stay true to your practice, and if you think your practice makes and transfers into book format, then great, make a book, but don't push it that way, because it's very apparent if your work doesn't suit that format, it doesn't work. There's a lot of people who make books, and when you die, it's something that outlives you, and you don't want to push it.
Hopefully something cheerful here.
I don't know, it's not that just about books, but I think if you're approaching making a book, definitely for when I approached this one, when you're starting a new work, you can get very insular very quickly. I think it's really important to use it as a chance to have as much dialogue as possible. I was really lucky to have editors and designers like around me when I was making it, and that allowed me to have regular conversations about my intentions, and also as much disagreeing with them enhanced my own ideas. So use as many opportunities as you can to have a dialogue about what you're making, and through that it will kind of progress and enhance the idea.
So what book is it on your mind?
Just Cornell. Do you know what? I don't buy books. I buy catalogues. I don't buy books, I buy catalogues. I'm obsessed about buying catalogues.
You mean catalogue or exhibition or survey books?
Yeah, so exhibition or catalogues. Yeah, I have 100
of
them at home. But we keep that secret. Joseph Cornell, I love that one. It's amazing. Absolutely incredible. Love it.
So, but it's more about the content, man. It's not about the form. I mean, most catalogues.
I quite like the simplicity of the tackle, but it just does what it says on the tin. It's there, and it just gives you all the images that you need. And I mean, I use it for, I put up these books for research. So, yeah, I mean, I'm so excited.
not a photo book compared, but I just recently bought a copy of Hannah Arendt's The Human Condition, and it's a really heavy theory, which I think will be really relevant to me in general. But what I've been really drawn to flipping through it is it's a really, really old text, and how the text is framed. So not the writing itself, but the decoration of each chapter and the lettering from the start and end of the page. And I think it's that, in terms of thinking about form, is really important, and how the viewer approaches something. So that's something that's been on my mind. a lot recently, not necessarily the content, but the framing of the content.
It's funny that you say, I think you will be bothered from the practice.
Yeah.
Like a kind of wishful thing.
Well, I've only read a chapter, but it seems to me it's pretty heavy stuff.
Slowly.
Do we have any question? You are strongly encouraged to go ahead.
It's not a question, it's just a comment. I think for me, sitting in the office, the hardest thing right now is to not be holding one of your books as you're talking about it, because you're talking about books, and or to not be at one of your performances and asking you to cut or not cut the pages. And so that's just a comment. I think you just, both of you, in the way you speak about your thoughts, has made me want to really look at your books. So thank you very much for your contributions.
That's a really interesting point, though, that actually we're talking about something which is so much about the tactility of an object, but yet we're all sitting there and it's being streamed online, and it actually blows my mind a little bit. Like, there should be something. We should all have a book in hand so we can look through the pages and the smells and... Let's get all the books out, Bruno.
But there's also the other thing that a lot of these books are about ideas.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm not saying that some of them, I'm not talking about yours or yours, that might be more disappointing. I mean, the idea might be even better than the object itself.
Never, ever.
Not in presence. But you see, some books, I think, they actually exist as a wonderful idea. And then, you know, the book itself, and, you know, if we look at, some of the conceptual artist books, and they're quite disappointing as objects. You know, it's more about the idea around them than the actual object itself.
Just to if you're thinking about it as an art form or an object, the success, whether it's conceptual or not, it's got to be that balancing and that binding between being conceptually solid, being academic to a point, also being, you know, acceptable and digestible for a lot of different people, but also that physical quality. It has to, as an object, it has to stand some weight. And actually, for me, unless the object itself is something that someone wants to hold, then it's completely failed. Personally,
I think that old people think quite differently about that.
Yeah, of course.
In terms of, you know, the book then is just there as a record of an idea, which is a completely different approach.
Yeah, absolutely.
Another question that kind of links into what you were talking about, and because both of your books are quite formative, I'm thinking about making a book at the moment, and I keep kind of coming up with these ideas and going, oh, maybe I should have that in there that takes it this. And where is the line, you, I suppose, between something that's interesting for the audience to interact with, or something, where does it sometimes sway into gimmick, or where do you may sometimes just see a book and you're like, oh, that's just a gimmick and it's not interesting. I don't know if you've got any advice on that and how.
There is a so many, because everyone makes books, so there is a tendency, I think there's definitely a kind of trending at the moment where people, not necessarily, but there's a few people who kind of do gimmicks, and there's things which are kind of leading into gimmicks, and I think which is a really fine line, and it's one you have to judge, and I think it's about integrity. Mm-hmm. And I think it's really about really asking yourself, questioning yourself, when you have no one else around, and say, if I saw that out, would I go, that's a bit close to the mark, it's a bit of a gimmick. Listen to your gut, because it's in your intuition. If you think it's a gimmick, it is a gimmick. Honestly, and I think sometimes it's like, go against whatever, even any advice. Deep down, you intrinsically know your practice more than anybody else in the world. Mm-hmm. And if you think it doesn't quite suffice, then it doesn't. So just stay really true to your practice. And then if you think it's right, you will.
Did you have a conversation with the people that you're working with? Because in your case, it's slightly different. Because of the price, you are people that you will meet every month. Consult you were given a designer to work with.
Yeah.
Were there ever conversation about, oh, this is a bit too crazy or enough?
The only thing is budget limitation. I wanted to go so much further with how I destroyed the book and how it was bound. So in that sense, the only thing that was convincing me not to do was because of budget. But apart from that, it was only... It was really entertaining working with a designer, because obviously being a designer you have everything really on point, and the fact that they could never have a true orientation for an image meant that they were just constantly trying to sequence a book which had no sequence, and they were trying to design a book which, yeah.
We must have loved
you.
What did you
want
to do?
What did I want to do? They convinced me to have it as a mailer separate to the book. I wanted the book to be bound inside the mailer, because that would have just been really much tighter, I think, as a concept. But just in terms of the cost of finishing in that way, just maybe it wasn't really worth it, because in terms of reaching an audience, it would only reach a few people, because I don't think, maybe.
I would make one, just see how I feel about it, honestly, because it's so much like part of what that project's about, that I don't think you'll ever let it go unless you do it. And I think you need to, like to do it, just to, even if you made it for you, it doesn't matter, you can keep them, because you never know, someone might pick it up, another publisher might pick it up, you don't know.
Yeah.
But actually for you and for the integrity of the project, it probably makes sense.
Yeah. But also book exists in the world, as in terms of, you're talking about distribution. I mean, there are a set of requirements for a book to exist, to go into bookstores or to be accessible economically, etc., etc. So I think it's interesting because that's what it was said yesterday as well, especially, I know, if I remember right, she was quite adamant about this thing. There shouldn't be any thought about how the book exists as a commercial object.
Mm.
And she was talking about cover and other things. Why Peter would say, well, at the end of the day, we want to make something that people can have and be attracted to, etc., etc. And it's quite an interesting balance, especially when you don't have a publisher, because sometimes the publisher is, and in a way, the designer kind of requires work. Your publisher are your publisher, so those things. Budget limitation, but also the nature of bookmaking and the existence of an object that needs to go around. So I think also that is something that maybe it shouldn't be taken into consideration if you're making an artist book, because then you only...
I think it's about whether you make a book which is going to be distributed in its printed in thousands, or you make a book and make a conceptual effort to make a book which is an artist book which is limited. I make artist books, and they're no more than 150 copies of that, so mine is. But it's small, because I don't want to be living in a house with boxes.
I just want a way for your catalogue, or your own work.
Yeah.
Have you thought about it? Is there any other questions? Yeah.
Sorry, I might have missed it at the beginning. But I guess I was wondering what initially inspired you to go with self-publishing rather than going with an established publisher or that kind of thing? Was it like control of the project or,
In my case, the big book there is my first book, and it's a self-published one. The reality is, if when you're kind of emerging and you do your first book, there's nothing prior for anyone to look at and say, okay, this was a really great success, we're going to make some money from this, which is what publishers are about. They want to make money, it's a business, it makes sense. So I didn't have anything as like a portfolio to show that this is what you'll make for the return. So, I was like, also I'm really, really impatient, so I'm like, right, I can't bother to work. I'm just going to start making it and just see what happens. I chose a designer in Amsterdam, worked with them very, very closely, but printed in Amsterdam, did everything, paid discussing that money for it all, but then made it and I had the creative control for it. So, and actually, for me, that was the most important thing, was making a book which is so odd. Making my designs to me, this is the craziest book we've ever done. Why would you ever get a book which is printed with nothing in it? And then you have to hand stick in 66 stickers by hand. If a book takes 3 hours to make, only an insane person would do that. Yeah, that's me. because of that, there's no publisher. The unit cost of the book is so high, there's no publisher that would take that. Funnily enough, like 3/4 of the way through, I did get a publisher approach with the last publisher, but then it was too late. But now they said it was their biggest.
Any other question?
When you were working on that book, you were kind of surrounded by designers and people kind of advising you on that. For anyone, any of you really, like, who, if you're in the process of making a book, how do you work with other people around that? Do you share it to friends? Do you share it to
Well, just quickly, the only, in terms of the making of, it was really, really nice to be in a chat studio. So I was in, at that time, I was in a studio with five of my friends in the castle, and they were kind of witnessing me making the work that we did. So I was making work which I was then bringing to the designers. So it was kind of two very different conversations in the same day, constantly back and forth. So yeah, I wasn't ever bringing work and asking to have conversations. It was kind of quote, like organic conversations through people witnessing work.
Yeah, that's the sort of, I work very closely with design too, so they're basically Utrecht just outside Amsterdam. And they know their number of things is out to professional and they're really clients and little women coming in and say, hi, can I make a book? And yeah, you know, they come from a very, I mean, so they come from a very good, they're not coming from work design, but they, you know, they're trained in that field and it's incredible that the things they suggest to you and the kind of organicness that grows from that. But also, I work very much in the township with the people I work with. It's very much about showing people, showing everybody, but not kind of going, this is my work, we can have a look at it. It's more kind of organic process, like Liam said, but you're just your natural environment, you really work with, they kind of say, well, what do you think the movies are on this? What do you think? And, but also, I mean, I also have a really clear mind, like, you know, the work, the book had to represent the, as close as possible, a tactile quality of the movie pieces. Mm-hmm. The only way to transfer that into something into a book form is to have something which was printed above and then used stuff on. So for me, for the first book, it only makes sense to work with that immediate concept. But I wouldn't necessarily work with that without my designers.
And in terms of designs, because I think it's something that it seems like people can be tempted to get a copy of InDesign and think, oh, I need to know how to do this. Like, how, for someone who has never made a book before, how do you approach that relationship, or how do you know where to go, or is that quite costly?
I mean, I feel that it's easier than you think, because there are designers around you.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know exactly here, but you know, if you are studying, then you probably are not too far from a designer.
Yeah.
If you, I mean, most people, you probably chose a designer based on the work they've done with other artists. And it's quite funny, but I think a lot of designers, if they are keen on the project, they are very willing, you know, to work on it. Even designers that you would think that are unreachable or established. And I think it's about matching the content with the right designer. So, you know, if the designer has a record of doing certain kind of books and you present a project that seems to be in that vein, I think they will be interested. I mean, of course, there's a monetary transaction that needs to happen, and that is an altogether different thing. But I think designers are there to choose, you know, work or stuff that they excite them,
yeah,
if they can.
Yeah.
Okay, is that any questions?
Well, it's more of like a statement rather than, I think you're both kind of concerned with physicality, and I think it's really a comment that you made that we weren't feared like experiencing it, because it's about the experience of the book. And I think, I don't know, the ideas that both of your work, they're beyond the book. Like the book is just the facilitator of the idea. And that's what I was really interested in. It's like the book is the medium, and it's kind of it's secondary. Rather, I think the ideas and the concepts are what gives the book its grounding.
Perfect conclusion for today's talks. So tomorrow we have
Tony
De Luca, who's the designer of most of the published books, and also is the New York Times editor. And we will be talking about design. He will be back. okay.